Tonight's program will feature a conversation between two prominent physicians, as you know, Dr. Richard Rockefeller and Dr. Larry Brilliant, talking about the creative possible uses of ecstasy to treat post-traumatic stress disorder. Dr. Brilliant is president and CEO of the Skoll Global Threats Fund. He previously was VP of Google and executive director of Google.org, rest in peace. And I'd like to also mention that he was also a co-founder of the Seva Foundation, which has helped alleviate blindness for 3.5 million people around the world. Now it's my pleasure to turn the program over to Dr. Larry Brilliant, who will introduce Dr. Rockefeller and start our radio broadcast. So please welcome Dr. Rockefeller and Dr. Brilliant.
I love this, actually. Good evening, and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org or download our iPhone and Android app for program information and to reserve tickets for upcoming events. I'm Larry Brilliant, president of the Skoll Foundation Global Threats Fund, co-founder of the Seva Foundation, and your chair for tonight's program. I'm very pleased to be able to introduce you and have a conversation with my friend, Dr. Richard Rockefeller. He's a former board member of Rockefeller University, former chair of the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, and also of the U.S. Advisory Board of Doctors Without Borders, Harvard Medical School. But he took a different course after medical school, became a family practitioner, board certified, raised in New York, lived in Maine, practiced and taught medicine in Portland, Maine, from 1982 to 2000. And what he did after that, he'll be telling you about tonight. Dr. Rockefeller is also the son of noted philanthropist David Rockefeller, who we learned earlier today spoke from this very podium about 10 years ago. Tonight, we will be discussing the treatment of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, an increasingly serious medical, social, and moral challenge in our modern world. There are several promising treatments in various stages of research, trial, and clinical use. One of these treatments, and one that we'll be talking about a lot today, is the drug MDMA, better known as ecstasy, or these days, Molly. Our conversation will span a great deal of territory tonight. We'll go from the frontiers of brain science to the exciting new possibility for easing human suffering. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Richard Rockefeller.
Thank you, Larry. I'm delighted to be here. I am an avid listener to the Commonwealth Club talks, and so it feels like an exalted forum for me to be presenting in. I dressed as in a suit because I'm an East Coaster tonight, but I hope that that doesn't offend anybody out here. So. When I was 19 years old, I had a girlfriend at Stanford, and I came out here and visited. And while we were driving through the leafy streets of Palo Alto in a beat-up maroon station wagon, a woman driving a car slipped her clutch and it jumped out of a side street and hit the tail of our car and spun us around into sideways into a tree, and it just indented about 2 feet just behind my head. And I was fine after a couple of days, but from then on right to the present moment, whenever a car seems to be moving too fast coming in from the right side, I tense up. But if a car comes from the left side, it has no such effect, very specific effect. That is called post-traumatic stress, but it's not post-traumatic stress disorder, which is a far more severe condition. Nowadays, by the way, a lot of people refer to it as post-traumatic stress so as not to stigmatize people with the condition. It is, however, a serious disorder. So I'm going to just talk to you for a minute about what it feels like from the inside of this condition, from other people's stories, because I don't suffer from it myself. But imagine that I am the classic Iraq soldier. I am now a veteran of the Iraq War. During that war, I experienced the explosion of an IED. This is the circumstance that most of you have know best about this condition. And since I returned from the war, I have the most striking symptom is flashbacks. And any loud noise will trigger the flashbacks. And a flashback is not a memory. When it occurs to me, I am in the driver's seat of that Humvee, re-experiencing the terror I felt as the world exploded around me. And my response to it every time is equivalent to the response I had when I was in the midst of this. That is, I have the emotional sensation of fear is just as large, and the physical effects are equally distressing to me. I have shaking and palpitations and sweating every time this happens. I also am constantly in a state of heightened arousal, so that it's hard for me to concentrate, it's hard for me to sleep, and when I do fall asleep, I wake up with flashbacks that again reinstate all of this. I'm irritable a lot of the time, I'm easily angered, and I'm hypervigilant, as though danger is just around the corner all the time for me. My sense of time is distorted. As I said, when this occurs, first of all, it's not a memory. All of a sudden, I am in the present moment with this occurring. But my sense of the future is also distorted. It's what the practitioners, clinicians treating this call foreshortened. I do not expect to have a long career or any career or a successful marriage. I don't expect to have children, and I don't expect a normal lifespan for myself. I avoid things, I avoid people and places and experiences that will trigger the flashbacks and the memories of this. I self-medicate in order to avoid those feelings. I drink too much alcohol, I take prescription drugs and non-prescription drugs and illegal drugs to block the memories of block the sensation. But my mind is also blocking memories. So there are important parts of the circumstances of the trauma that I cannot actually remember if you were to ask me about them. And that spills over into the rest of my memory and the rest of my mental functioning. So there's all kinds of things I don't remember, and I don't seem as smart as I actually am because my mind, part of the reason is that the energy of my mind is spent not remembering and not re-experiencing these incredibly painful events. The result of all of this is that my life feels as though it's falling apart. My marriage is on the rocks. It's very hard for me to hold a job. I think a lot about suicide. And other people around me, it's a great cause of guilt and shame that people around me are equivalently affected. Some people close to me are actually suffering symptoms of PTSD themselves. Their ripple effects of this go on, and I will talk about this a little bit later, but PTSD is actually never a solitary event for the person who has it. It affects, like an infectious disease, it affects people around them. I've given you the classic story of a veteran with post-traumatic stress disorder, but there are many other varieties and flavors. In fact, there are far more people in the world who have what's called complex PTSD, not from a single event, but from multiple events during their lifetime, often from sexual abuse or violence as children. And the triggers, I mentioned a very obvious trigger, a loud noise, but the triggers can be equally subtle, like in my real case of the car coming from the right side. But people have described the exact formation of trees lining a road that they saw preceding some sort of a trauma. And whenever they see trees close to that, they are triggered. I have a friend who all his friends died during the AIDS epidemic, the last one in 1991. And he wasn't traumatized until his last friend died. But now what triggers him is the sound of his friend's limp in the last stages of his trauma. As they walked along the street, whenever he hears anyone limp, he is traumatized again. So what's going on here? One remarkable thing is the rate of advancement of neuroscience in all realms, but particularly around trauma and what is causing all of these symptoms to occur in people. The PTSD is a disorder above all of modulation of fear, and fear is modulated above all by a small organ in the center of our brain called the amygdala. There are many other parts of the brain that are equally involved in fear processing, but the amygdala is the central one. It's like a TSA screener, and it's supposed to be there. It's a good thing to be screening for things. None of us would be alive if we didn't have it doing that, because our ancestors, for example, survived attacks of saber-toothed tigers, because the first time they heard a saber-toothed tiger and it sprang, their amygdala remembered absolutely the sound of the claws scratching or the growl of the saber-toothed tiger. And when they heard that again, they never had to think about it at all. They reacted absolutely suddenly with fear, but the appropriate flight response or fight response or whatever it was. But with PTSD, the amygdala with PTSD is like a TSA screener gone wild, constantly saying that there is danger and that we need to take care of this where there is no danger. There's another part of the brain called the prefrontal cortex, which is like the TSA screener's manager that's supposed to calm things down. Or like if the amygdala was like a screaming child, the prefrontal cortex is like a parent that would provide comfort. And in PTSD, neither the amygdala is under control, nor is the prefrontal cortex doing its job as it should. The amygdala not only processes fear, and by the way, for all of you sitting here tonight, your amygdala is at work checking out all of this for safety. But in the course of the evening, it will decide whatever's happening here is safe, and it will be sending the memory of what goes on here to other parts of the brain. With people with PTSD, the memory gets stuck inside the amygdala, and it doesn't let it go. And every time the memory is triggered, the fear is so intense, both the emotional and the physical aspects of it, that the amygdala is re-traumatized. So it just goes round and round and round back into the amygdala. In people resilient, by the way, not everybody gets PTSD. Only about maybe 20% of everybody who experiences trauma develops the syndrome called post-traumatic stress disorder. In most of us, over time, we reprocess the memory and send it up to other parts of the brain where it needs to go, and it's not connected to the fear response. But in people vulnerable to PTSD, as I say, they get re-traumatized each time, and the fear response is coupled to the memory for far too long. In fact, for many people, unless they get treated, for the entire rest of their lives, it doesn't go away. Let me talk for a minute about how large a problem PTSD is. It has been estimated that about 90% of Americans experience trauma sufficient to cause PTSD at least once in their lifetime. But as I say, most of them don't actually develop the syndrome. They restore the memory to the right place in their brains. But about 7% of the general population does develop PTSD. That's about 25 million people in this country. It's a much higher rate among veterans of the recent wars, 30%. But of course, the total numbers of people with PTSD resulting from those wars is smaller because it's a smaller number of veterans and active soldiers. Worldwide, it is vastly higher, but we don't know how high it is because we don't have any instruments at the moment for measuring international levels of post-traumatic stress. The suicide rate among people with PTSD is probably about twice as high as it is for people with other conditions. At this point, it is estimated that on average, one vet commits suicide, one veteran commits suicide every 90 minutes. In 2012 was the first year that more people committed suicide among active duty soldiers than died in combat. In part, that's because fewer people die in combat, but it's still a kind of a shocking figure. If you count the entire active duty population plus the veterans, 18 times as many people commit suicide every year as die in combat at this point. As I say, the suffering that's caused is not limited to the people who suffered the trauma. It spreads to members of their family and to their communities. And it even spreads to volunteers who work with PTSD. That's called a vicarious trauma or a secondary trauma. So it really, there are many ways in which it really does act as though it was an infection. The economic cost, I actually don't know the cost for the general population, but the military tracks this very carefully. Just for disability alone, the cost to the Veterans Administration is $1 million lifetime cost per veteran that's traumatized. And the disability payments at this point are $5.5 billion per year by the Veterans Administration. Besides the economic costs and the emotional costs, of course, there are the moral costs to all of us, really, and to the VA and to the Department of Defense. So that's a bit of background on what PTSD is.
Thank you. The first time I heard this from Richard, I was taken aback. How could this silent epidemic exist in our society as a consequence of modernity in many ways, and we not know about it? And I'm just so pleased that you agreed to come, and how fortunate we are to have you here to begin a conversation that's going to last a lifetime, I think, for many of us. And just as a reminder, if in the course of the conversation, if you hear something that gets your interest going and you want to ask a question, there are some cards that are being circulated. If you'd write down, there we go. If you write down your question on the cards, they'll be collected and brought up here. And then when Richard's answering one question, I'm going to be furiously going through those cards and see which ones we can ask him next. And I'm going to start off with the toughest one, if I can, or the most apt one, I think. So now we have an understanding of the epidemic. We have an epidemic of how large it is, its cost in human suffering, and in dollars. And you want to talk about ecstasy. What does all this have to do with ecstasy?
So first I want to talk about what we know about the treatment of PTSD in general. Unfortunately, it is an epidemic. It is growing worldwide, but in this country, for reasons that I actually don't fully understand, there's much more post-traumatic stress disorder than there used to be. Fortunately, our understanding of the neuroscience of trauma has been increasing very rapidly. It's all very recent. The understanding began only about 20 years ago. And here's what we know about, I mentioned the neuroscience of trauma itself, but the neuroscience of treatment. It's actually simple to state what's needed in order to treat post-traumatic stress. You need a detailed recall of the trauma in a setting of extreme safety. If you can achieve the safety and you can achieve very highly detailed recall, you can actually take the trauma and move it out of the amygdala and move it to parts of the brain where it's supposed to go. Reconsolidation is what that process is called. The brain is insanely complex, and yet it's possible to describe what's happening here in an almost counterintuitively simple way. It's as though memories, and this is true for memory in general, that when you take memory out of one place in the brain, it's literally as though you're removing a physical object. If you take it out of the brain and put it into consciousness, so now I'm thinking about this thing. And with any memory, if you were now to give me a drug that blocks creation of memory, that memory would be gone for good. Who knew, right? That it's very surprising. If, and that's not what we're doing, by the way, with MDMA. People have talked about that, but there's moral implications of simply obliterating memories that exist in trauma, particularly for populations who have been victimized. The last thing people want to do is forget that that occurred. But if you can take a traumatic memory and create a situation that is intensely safe, and then hold that in detail for long enough, like an hour or 2 hours or maybe 3 hours, you can reconsolidate that memory into the parts of the brain, and I won't start naming them here, there are quite a few of them, where those memories should have ended up in the first place. There are therapies out there that achieve this to a greater and lesser extent. You may have heard some of the names of them. There's cognitive processing therapy, prolonged exposure therapy, EMDR, which is eye movement desensitization and reprocessing. And there are two antidepressants, Zoloft and Paxil, that are approved for treating PTSD. In addition to those are the approved therapies. In addition to approved therapies, there are a great many kind of alternative therapies that people are trying, and I'll just read a little list of them. Hypnosis, yoga, meditation, art therapy, music therapy, nature therapy, wilderness therapy, horseback riding therapy, and pet therapy, and that's really not all. And people are trying other currently legal drugs, some of them with quite interesting results. So prazosin, propranolol, D-cycloserine, Benadryl, insulin, and also cannabis for treating PTSD. How effective are these? When I was in medical school, it was a kind of a common truth that for any condition, the likelihood that you had a good treatment was inversely proportional to the number of treatments available to treat it. For the for therapies that were highly effective, one would do it. So, but there is real success, and the proponents of each of these modalities will argue in favor of the high rate of success that they have. In the end, it doesn't matter that whether it's 50% or 80%, what we have out of, say, 25 million traumatized people in the US is a gigantic number of people who are not having their condition treated effectively at all. So MDMA-assisted psychotherapy for PTSD. Here's what the evidence is so far is showing. After a 14-week total course that includes only 3 8-hour sessions of MDMA, again, ecstasy, we're seeing somewhere above an 80% remission rate, so that people who qualify, and I'll get to who these people are in a minute.
80%?
0%. Who are these people? The FDA, these are FDA-approved trials. Obviously, MDMA, ecstasy, is an illegal drug, but it has been approved by the FDA and the DEA and other organizations for this therapy. The only way they allowed the researchers to conduct the research was, and this is correct ethically, you have to take the people that are not responding to other treatments. So these are people with moderate to severe, and more of them with severe cases of MDMA. It is chronic. In the first study that was published, there's almost a median of 19 years suffering from PTSD. And it is treatment resistant. Each of them had to have failed at least one drug therapy and at least one psychotherapy, and in many cases they had failed more than that. So among that group who have failed therapy and they're severe, we're seeing above an 80% success rate. Is it a lasting effect? It is. There is now a long-term follow-up study that was published just a year ago that shows over a median of 3.5 years follow-up, but with as long as 9 years follow-up, almost all the original people out of 20 people treated still did not meet criteria for PTSD. So it's physicians are hesitant to use the word cure because it has a very specific meaning, but we use the word durable remission, and in this case, very happily so. This appears to be a durable remission in the most difficult cases to treat. So, and I'll, if you like, I will talk about the experience of MDMA.
Hold that for just a moment. Yeah. The experience of MDMA, while everybody writes down your questions. And I want to just remind everybody, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Our speaker today is Dr. Richard Rockefeller, former board member of Rockefeller University, former chair of the U.S. Advisory Board of Doctors Without Borders. I'm Larry Brilliant, president of the Skoll Global Threats Fund, co-founder of the SAVA Foundation. We are discussing the possible use of the drug MDMA, better known as ecstasy or Molly, to effectively treat or even cure post-traumatic stress disorders. You can also find video of Commonwealth Club programs online at FORA.tv, FORA.tv. So I think everybody would like to hear your description of the experience. Maybe if we could begin to have some of the cards brought forward, and we'll start taking a look at those. And please, Richard, I think that'd be this would be a good time to talk about that.
Good. And by the way, I'm not going to talk about the experience of actually just taking MDMA. This is the experience of being a patient using MDMA-assisted psychotherapy. And I feel a little bit like an imposter because with us tonight is Dr. Michael Mithofer, who is the principal investigator in all of the early research on this, who could tell you much better than I, but I'm the only one with a microphone taped to my lapel. So I will do what I can. One of the people I have met who has been treated with this therapy had been in insight-oriented talk psychotherapy for a very long time before. And she said that talking at such great length was like mapping her prison down to the last brick and the last little bit of mortar and spider web and crack in the door, but she was still in prison. And the experience of MDMA-assisted psychotherapy was like continuing to map the prison, but all of a sudden seeing a door open and walking through the door. Now, I hesitate to use her quotation because it sounds pretty magical, but I will also say that for people who have experienced this, it does occur in moments that feel magical. By the way, it's called ecstasy, so for the normal population, when you're not trying to deal with trauma, it can be a lot of fun. It's very peaceful, and you feel tremendous trust and tremendous safety. But for people doing the trauma work, all they do is feel safe enough. It's not fun for them, but it is safe enough that they are, in the course of the therapy, able to bring up memories of their traumas, and they can actually feel them being moved to other parts of their brain. This is not, by the way, just about the drug. As I said before, it requires a sense of safety. It also requires a deep sense of trust, and that requires a very strong alliance with the therapist. So the way the Mithofers and other people who are approaching this do that is with a non-directive type of psychotherapy. They do not have a protocol saying, now you must start telling me about your trauma. On the contrary, no acute trauma or almost no acute trauma arises without a history of some kind of either family trauma for that person or childhood trauma. Those are the people who are susceptible to developing it. And when you use this kind of psychotherapy, you don't know which parts of that story need to arise first. If you go straight to the trauma, the IED bomb that exploded or whatnot, you may not get there. So you have to allow the patient, very often in long, long periods of silence, to go inwards and see what is arising. And out of that, they're able to recall what they need and reconsolidate it to other parts of the brain. The Mithofers call that the inner healing intelligence, which again, after I was fortunate to do a training session with Michael and his wife Annie in Charleston, South Carolina, where we watched probably 12 hours or so of videotape of people undergoing the therapy. And you begin to believe that there is an inner healing intelligence. People will go, you don't watch the hour that they're silent, of course, but you see there's a gap of an hour. And out of that comes this intense, detailed recollection of trauma that they may, in many cases, have forgotten entirely. One more thing about the studies themselves. They are still small. The original published study was only on 20 participants. At this point, there are about 60 people in studies around the world, and they're not just in the US. Michael and Annie have got a second study going in Charleston, South Carolina. A study has begun in Boulder, but there are studies beginning in Israel, England. There's one completed in Switzerland, and one about to begin in Canada. So out of all of those so far, there are about 60 patients. If you were seeing what's called an effect size of only 5%, you would need far, far more people to be able to be in any way convinced that this is effective. But when you see people go from a scoring system, the old scoring system was 0 to 120, and on average these patients are around 75, which is right on the border of moderate to severe. When you see them go down to a 4 or a 5 or a 10, that's a gigantic effect size, and so the numbers of 60 people who have been treated actually has statistical significance.
We're getting a lot of questions about the exact protocol that's being used for these studies, and I think you've touched on much of it. But because there are so many wonderful questions on that subject, maybe you would just talk a little bit about what is the therapeutic setting, how is the drug administered, all of those things.
Good. So the setting is quite informal, but again, very peaceful and safe. In the Mithoffer's case, it is set up like a living room because the drug, when it's at its peak effect, makes people often want to lie down. There's a couch that's folded out, but they can sit up as well. When they go inward, it's best to really close out stimuli from the outside world, so people put on eye shades, but they also listen to music because music and their own breathing help maintain conditions of the deep safety that they need to recollect their traumatic memories. And Michael and his wife Annie are always present, in part because the FDA insisted on it, but in part because that's a good way to go. You don't know, even if somebody just has a war trauma or they're a veteran veteran firefighter, in all likelihood, there are childhood memories that will come up that may very well involve sexual abuse. So having a male-female team is required at the moment and may be so right into the future for doing this. Besides that, the MDMA, by the way, is treated as though it was plutonium. The FDA and DEA insist that it be kept inside of a specified safe with no access in that room to an outside wall so that criminals can't drill in and carry off the safe. It's a little over the top, but there you have it. That accounts for some of the expense of the research.
We have a lot of questions asking, is there any evidence that you could use to distinguish someone who is likely to be more vulnerable to trauma, who might be more likely to get PTSD or PTS? And if you know of any studies like that that you could guide the listeners to that would help them distinguish who's more vulnerable to
sure.
it.
Sure. I don't know the details. The Veterans Administration actually has, and the Department of Defense has invested a huge amount of money in trying to determine vulnerability versus resilience, and also research into how to increase resilience, because obviously they lose morally and economically and every other way if their soldiers have to leave the battlefield, and likewise, tremendous cost to the VA. I don't know all the details of it. The highest risk factors are prior trauma and family history of trauma.
So We have a category of questions. I'll read you a couple of them.
Yep.
To what extent does the basic mindset of the American medical establishment need to change in order to accept treatments such as ecstasy for PTSD? And another related one, in the early 80s, late 70s, I'm having trouble reading some of the writing, I apologize. Researchers in the 60s were successfully using LSD to treat PTSD in the Vietnam era. What makes you think you will have any more luck in legislation than they have? Mm-hmm. So I think those are related questions
about
attitudes.
They are related questions. And I don't think I'll try to address the one about the American medical establishment, because I don't think that's really the greatest barrier here. We have bureaucracies that are a barrier. The DEA in particular, which arose out of what I consider to be the traumas of the 60s. Let me just back up on that for a second, because it's a complicated argument. My parents' generation went through two world wars and the Depression, and there's no question that there was a whole lot of post-traumatic stress among that population. The overt ones had what was called shell shock from the wars, but when the 50s came along, it was as though a blanket had put down over all that stress. The safety of that time was economic growth and economic security and education for everybody, and it was a period of seeming optimism. And when Timothy Leary and others in the 60s came along with LSD and people started taking it in large numbers and tuning in, turning on, and dropping out of school, I actually think that my parents' generation was significantly traumatized by that, real trauma. And I think that out of that trauma arose certain kinds of political orientations that led to the election of very conservative presidents and the creation of the DEA and the war on drugs. And we're living with what I take to be a legacy of that trauma, and it's ironic that we're using a drug that's called a psychedelic drug. It's not a hallucinogen, by the way, but it's still called it's a mind-manifesting psychedelic drug, that we may be able to use the drug that, in part, caused the trauma to treat the very trauma. But it remains a barrier, the fact that there's a legacy within the DEA, and I think that that's what we have to overcome. There's another legacy, of course, which is this has become a party drug. Ecstasy was used in the rave scene in the late 70s and 80s and still is. There is all kinds of misinformation about it. By the way, governments, not just the U.S. government, but others around the world, spent somewhere close to $300 million in the 80s trying to prove that this was a highly toxic drug so that they could render it illegal. So we have better toxicity data on this than any other drug that I'm aware of, and they were not able to do so. I'll get back to toxicity if you like. But the fact is that I was actually just talking with a young woman last evening who said she had learned in junior high school that ecstasy causes holes in your brain, and many of you may have heard that same thing. It turns out to be absolutely untrue, but in the public mind, a drug that's called a psychedelic, so triggers to multi-generational trauma there, plus misinformation has created a whole population and an establishment that's resistant to the idea that this could be true.
Here's a question that combines ecstasy, PTSD, and epidemiology, which is good. Please say more about the infectiousness of PTSD to family, friends, or coworkers. If I have PTSD, how do I not infect my loved ones?
Yeah, I'll answer the latter point first, and that's very short. I don't know, actually, because people who have untreated PTSD do infect their loved ones. The science of multi-generational PTSD is a relatively new one. It began with studies of descendants of Holocaust survivors, and it has been assumed that the outright activities of the parents carried down the trauma to their children, that it was mainly behavioral. The worst predictor of passing along that trauma to children is what's called the conspiracy of silence. And people with trauma do not want to talk about it, but when they don't talk about it with their children, that predicts to the children being extremely vulnerable to developing PTSD. But more recently, this is extremely interesting, and it brings to mind a quote from the J.B.S. Haldane said that the universe is not only queerer than you think it is, it's queerer than you're even able to think it is. So this is, here's a brand new fact about the transmission of PTSD to new generations. PTSD is not in our DNA, but it turns out that it is. It does affect what's called the epigenetics, not only in the individual. So epigenetics, I will not go into it, and I'm not an expert anyway, but there are control proteins and modifications to your DNA that either increase or decrease expression of certain genes to produce proteins. It has been learned that in individuals who are extremely stressed, their epigenetics changes very substantially, so that their ability, for example, to release cortisol in response to stress is altered, and like other epinephrine and other neurochemicals. In the last couple of years, it has been shown that that gets passed down to offspring. Both in humans, women who are stressed during pregnancy, you can measure epigenetic changes in their children. They've now studied multiple generations of unfortunate lab animals. So they, just in the last month, a study was published where they exposed rats to the smell of cherry blossoms, of all things, while giving them an aversive stimulus. And not only did those rats become averse to the smell of cherry blossoms, but so did their children, and so did their children's children, without ever having smelt cherry blossoms before. So that's the weirdness of the universe. And that, so we don't know all the mechanisms for transmitting it, but it really does, no kidding, behave like, it's not just a metaphor, it behaves like an infection.
A reminder, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Our speaker today is Dr. Richard Rockefeller, former board member of Rockefeller University and the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. I'm Larry Brilliant, president of the Skoll Global Threats Fund and co-founder of the SABA Foundation. We're discussing the possible use of the drug MDMA to effectively treat or even cure post-traumatic stress syndromes. You can also find video of the Commonwealth Club programs online at FORATV, F-O-R-A-TV. Richard, was the 80% figure that you mentioned, is that usually a one-dose protocol or multi-dose protocol?
It's multi-dose. I mentioned it, but I was throwing a lot at you. So in 14 weeks that involve a lot of a number of sessions of non-drug psychotherapy, there are also three MDMA sessions, 8 hours long, about a month apart, during the course of this. So
if your child suffered from PTSD, is MDMA the first line therapy that you would choose? If not, what is? And what about side effects that would especially concern you?
We don't have any evidence about efficacy of MDMA for children. We do know that children are, on the whole, much more resilient to development of PTSD than adults are. But certainly I would not recommend, first of all, it remains illegal for the general population, so it can't be first-line therapy. It'll require a lot more research before we have any idea whether it would be appropriate for kids.
What other drugs have been used in current research in similar settings, and have their results been better, worse, or any that are about the same?
It's only extremely recently that any drugs have been used in combination, at least to my knowledge, in combination with psychotherapy. One remarkable recent publication showed that using a very common cardiac drug, propranolol, which people take, by the way, for stage fright in case to block palpitations and dry mouth.
Professional golfers have been known to take for those 3-foot putts.
So if this is The report said that simply getting somebody, this wasn't severe trauma, and I have no knowledge of how chronic it had been or resistant, but getting a person to take propranolol and then a half an hour later write down the details of their trauma dramatically reduced their symptoms of PTSD. So I do want to make the point that MDMA is a waypoint. It's not going to be the be-all and end-all. We're learning a whole lot, and over time, there will be other drugs and other psychotherapies that work. But we don't have enough data to really compare efficacy. There is nothing on the horizon, nothing that I know of that treats severe chronic treatment-resistant PTSD the way MDMA appears to do.
I don't know if this is a scientific study, but the many times I've done this, I've never had this many questions, so that's an indicator of something. Are the therapists required to be familiar with the MDMA experience outside of a therapeutic session? That's one question. And the other related, what is done to help patients integrate this experience after the session?
Good questions. The FDA has approved the use of MDMA by the therapists themselves. I think that's the meaning of the import of the question. So, and that's a really good idea, because this is not like anything else that they, in fact, one of the bottlenecks, if this gets approved, we're going to have a big bottleneck, which is to have enough therapists who are able to conduct these sessions. And this is probably a little jaded on my part, but if you were to take just a group of psychotherapists versus people who, experienced psychotherapists versus people who are just in training, you might have an easier time with the people in training, because the experienced psychotherapists are going to have to unlearn a lot of what they've been doing for a long time in terms of engagement with the patients during the sessions.
Are there any studies or any good results using athletes who were treated for head trauma or PTSD or depression?
Not that I know of. And by the way, a great many people with PTSD coming out of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars have simultaneously got traumatic brain injury and PTSD. And for the moment, I believe that they are, is that true, Michael? Are they allowed to be in the study or not, with if they have TBI? They can be accepted. Yeah. So Michael is saying that if it's severe and persistent, maybe not, but if it's not persistent brain injury, then they can get into the studies. Was there another question in there?
No, that's okay. We've got so many. It's really, really wonderful to have so many questions. Could I have some of the folks here from MAPS, please raise your hand? All of you around, just notice these guys, because there are at least six questions that are along the lines of, Dr. Rockefeller, what can those of us here tonight do to bring this treatment to people who need it? Are there things that can be done to accelerate this process, fundraising, etc.? So those hands that you just raised, keep that in consideration. Is there a corollary for those who are most likely to get trauma and those who are likely to be healed by MDMA with therapy?
I don't know the answer to that, but somebody who coached me for this said, well, if you don't know the answer, answer a different question. So I'll do that. It's actually a good question. It is a very related question, which has to do with the people. We don't know who will respond best, but what we do know is that people with relatively acute wartime trauma and people who have complex childhood trauma respond equally well to each other. At least that's what the studies show so far, which is not true for the other modalities, which mostly are effective for more recent trauma, and very few of them are effective for recurrent childhood trauma.
So I've been asked to ask all of you here in the audience, we can't do this for the radio audience, to raise your hand if you have or know somebody who has PTSD.
Goodness.
And for the radio audience, I'll tell you, what is that, 70%, 60% of the audience? I mean, that's pretty amazing. And
yeah.
It's a self-selected sample, but it's a very impressive and a very sad commentary, I think, on modernity nonetheless. Can you elaborate on the difference between post-traumatic stress and post-traumatic stress syndrome or post-traumatic stress disorder? I'm confused.
Yeah. So again, everybody, or almost, there are three classes of people, according to some researchers, which is those who are resistant and never get any kind of post-traumatic symptoms at all, a very small minority, those who are resilient, and those who are susceptible. So the people who are resilient can absolutely and do get post-traumatic stress. They get stressed after trauma, so hence post-traumatic stress. But the disorder is the much more severe and persistent re-traumatization that occurs for years and perhaps forever.
Do you anticipate other MDMA-assisted therapy being approved for other less severe illnesses or even non-illnesses like grief counseling, marriage counseling, and so on?
When MDMA was legal, which it was between 1975 and 1985, a lot of therapists, actually, especially in the Bay Area, used MDMA for couples therapy in particular. Out of that arose a lot of anecdotal evidence that it was also good for other conditions, anxiety, phobias, and PTSD, but none of those were controlled studies. Interestingly, Stanford is about to begin a study for using MDMA for people with autism spectrum disorder, and we shall see. And the reason that came out is people wrote on websites who had used MDMA recreationally, people who had Asperger's and other autism spectrum disorders, they wrote that they wrote in testimonials that it seemed to get better, at least during the MDMA experience, and then many cases it was decreased afterwards.
What were the most common side effects experienced by PTSD patients post-MDMA treatment?
Post-treatment? I'm not aware of side effects after. Is that...
But side effects of MDMA
right.
usage or side effects of PTSD after treatment, either of those?
Well, it's... People still struggle with the memory of their trauma after their therapy. If they had severe PTSD, it's not a happy memory, but it doesn't trigger the same things. But I don't call that a side effect. That's simply that they have ameliorated their symptoms quite a bit. And I don't know that there are any symptoms at all of side effects from MDMA after the treatment. There are, by the way, toxicities.
What are those
MDMA.
Toxicities?
The most severe toxicity for people in the rave scene is use of too much MDMA or use of MDMA with other substances or use of what they thought was MDMA or Molly or ecstasy, but it really wasn't. So actually the largest number of people who experience side effects are in that scene. But all drugs have problems, and this one does too. It dysregulates It alters your thermal regulation, so if you take it too much and dance all night, you can die from, they come into emergency rooms with a temperature of 107. It also, people get a dry mouth, so they think they're dehydrated and they can drink too much, and they dilute their serum and their brain swells, or they get fatal cardiac arrhythmias. These are documented, but they're extremely rare, I should say, out of huge, huge numbers of people who've done this on the rave scene.
Do you have any information about similar use of marijuana in similar kinds of guided therapeutic sessions for PTSD?
I don't know. Other people in the room may know of the answer to that specific question. I do know that marijuana has been used not in controlled studies yet because NIDA will not allow us to do controlled studies. They have a monopoly on marijuana and they are not releasing it for these studies. But anecdotally, marijuana has been used for treating symptoms. It's not curative. You don't get remissions the way you do with MDMA. And by the way, there was mention of earlier the question about LSD and PTSD, and there's a lot of reason to believe that the mechanism is favorable to MDMA over LSD for treating PTSD.
Here's the best question. What have we forgot to ask you?
So there One has to, one that you actually proposed to me before this, but you've forgotten.
It happens.
Is why I care so much about this. And I think it's kind of interesting. And it has to do, by the way, with your work as well as mine. You were involved with the eradication of smallpox from the face of the earth through the World Health Organization. And I've been involved for years with Doctors Without Borders. I was with Doctors Without Borders in 1999 when we did several things with ACT UP, the gay rights advocacy group, stopping at every whistle stop of Al Gore when Clinton was running for president again and asking why the administration was blocking the change to the blocking the WHO's intellectual property agreement, where there's an escape clause and you can actually make drugs, you can force people to be, force the pharmaceutical companies to allow generic production of drugs. Simultaneously, we sent letters to 17 of the world's largest pharmaceutical companies in 1 week, and the Clinton administration and the pharmaceutical companies gave in, and within a week, all of them said, yes, you can produce antiretrovirals for AIDS, HIV/AIDS. And within a year, as a result of that, the cost to treatment around the world went down from $15,000 per patient to $300 per patient. Simultaneously, these groups forced governments around the world to start treating their populations against conventional wisdom, and things changed very, very fast. So now we're looking in the rearview mirror at international AIDS to a large degree. Everybody said that couldn't be done. I'm sure everybody said at the beginning of the 20th century you could never eliminate smallpox, but you and I both have experience seeing where something of enormous danger to the world can actually be changed very quickly. So that one of the reasons I'm enthusiastic is because I'm so hopeful. And I'll give one other example. In the year 2000, I was diagnosed with a particular kind of leukemia for which, to my knowledge at that point, there was no good treatment besides bone marrow transplant. And if you couldn't get a bone marrow transplant, your median survival expectation was 4 years. It happened that the most effective drug ever produced for cancer was produced for my type of leukemia and became available within 6 months. So I felt like Mr. Magoo walking off the skyscraper with a girder coming around, and I just happened to step onto it and keep walking. And my life was absolutely saved, and it would not have been saved without accelerated approval of Gleevec, the drug that I experienced. And in a way, this is the work here is paying forward my gratitude.
That's wonderful. What's next on this journey for you?
Accelerated approval, and then after that, actually, the pursuit of the question of multi-generational trauma as an international public health crisis, again, making it visible to the world first, and then studying it, and then seeing whether any of what we're learning of the neuroscience of individual trauma can be applied to the scourge of trauma around the world. And if it can, by the way, I come from a lineage of John D. Rockefeller was in creating the Rockefeller Foundation. He was deeply interested in root causes, and in some ways he invented strategic philanthropy, and I kind of carry that desire with me. And I do believe that as global warming is a root cause, without treating global warming, we can't take care of any other environmental problems. And I look upon PTSD internationally as a root cause, without which, by the way, we will not take care of global warming or any other of the major environmental threats to our population, because people who have no sense of time, if they have a foreshortened future, they sure cannot vote for anything that is going to decrease the amount of carbon that they're putting into the atmosphere. So I'm motivated that way as well.
Well, I was privileged to be at the Rockefeller Foundation 100-year anniversary celebrations 6 weeks ago. And for those of you who don't know, the Rockefeller Foundation created my field, created public health. It did the first eradication program of hookworm. It worked to fund all the yellow fever vaccination studies and really has brought us so many firsts in the field of strategic philanthropy. And it sounds like you're a worthy torchbearer of that.
I have a lot to live up to.
We're running out of time. I have a chance for you to answer a couple of questions that you'd like to. We've got a chance for one more question from the audience. And the question from the audience is, all of these have asked the same question, which may not surprise you, which is, how do I sign up to be in this clinical trial? And can you let me know when there's one coming to a radio station close to me?
One interesting thing is that there's a unlike almost all clinical trials for all drugs and therapies, where it's hard to sign people up, as you can imagine, there's a gigantic backlog of people who would like to get in these trials. And unfortunately, we're still talking very tiny numbers. I don't have an answer to how you can sign up or where to go. You can perhaps talk with Michael and Rick after this and besiege them a little bit, but I don't. I'm not sure how you would get in line for this. The main thing is if you can support this work. I mean, to get from here to, at least according to the current trajectory, we're going to have to complete what's called phase two trials and do phase three trials. To get to the end of that is going to cost $20 million, which compared to $5.5 billion per year taking care of the veterans, it's absolutely negligible. But in this day and age, it's with a drug that has got a problematic name, it's hard to raise $20 million. So if we can get there, we will be able to move a little bit faster.
I do want to say one bit of encouragement from the smallpox eradication program. You're completely right that there were a lot of skeptics right up to the end. In fact, one of our primary skeptics was the head of communicable diseases from the World Health Organization, which is a tough person to be a skeptic. In fact, he offered to bet us that we would never eradicate smallpox, and if we could, he would eat the tire from a Land Rover. And I want to report that I had the exquisite pleasure of finding a tire, putting it in a box, and sending him a telex and asking him to kindly let us know if he wanted mustard or ketchup, and to comment on the bouquet and the flavor, and whether it had that peculiar raspberry or cedar taste to it. All right, we are at the end of our program. I want to thank all the audience. I want to thank Richard Rockefeller, my dear friend, former board member of the Rockefeller University and Rockefeller Brothers Fund. We want to thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. I'm Dr. Larry Brilliant, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.